Retro.
Hello there. This is James Arnold Taylor, the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continuously unexpected. So uncivilized.
This is podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, this is Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to Podcast Stardust, the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Tonight, we'll be discussing our final section from A Certain Point of View, The Empire Strikes Back. But before we get into that discussion, Jay, can you remind everybody where they can find us online and around the internet?
Absolutely. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
So this is the final segment from a certain point of view, The Empire Strikes Back. We've previously discussed the stories that revolved around Hoth in the first portion of our discussion. The second portion of our discussion was Luke's time on Dagobah and the Millennium Falcon as it was in the asteroid field and evading the Empire. Now, this third section primarily deals with what happens on Cloud City and the escape from Cloud City going forth. And this will be a spoiler discussion. We're not going to cover all the stories, but we're going to cover some of our favorites and then maybe get into a few that didn't quite work for us. But with that being said, Jay, I kind of found that this third part was my least favorite of the three. I really enjoyed the Hoth sections and the Hoth stories, I should say, and then all of the stories from, or most of the stories from that middle portion that deal with the flight from the Empire. But there was just not as great a consistency, I think, in this final section of the book. What did you think overall?
I actually liked it more so than I thought I would. The first couple of stories were kind of just meh. But then there was something endearing about several of these stories, which kind of really surprised me. But I feel that there were a lot more, I guess, obscure sorts of things going on in some of these and some really kind of confusing stories as well. But yeah, there were some that I found that I just absolutely fell in love with. So for me, it kind of tipped the scales a little bit more to say that it kind of puts it even with some of the other stories that we've talked about. And I can't really say that I liked it less than any of the other segments that we've done.
Fair enough. Okay. Well, with that having been said, again, let's get into our favorites here. I don't have them in a particular order, but what was one that stood out to you?
My favorite in this entire section was Faith and an Old Friend by Brittany N. Williams. So this is the story about our friend L337 and how she gets along with the other two droid brains in the Millennium Falcon. And I absolutely love the story. I loved it from the audio version of it. I love being able to hear and experience L3's wittiness, you know, once again, and just the way that she was still almost adapting to not having her droid full self. And she was making comments about, you know, she had such wonderful shoulders and she missed her legs, but yet the other two consciousness that she was with, so it was herself, V5T, and ED4. And each one of them, they were all sisters. And so it was this Millennium Collective is what they called it. And so all three of them were able to operate together, but yet still celebrate each of their individualities, which is something that L3 taught them. And she taught them vocabulary and just the way that C-3PO and R2 interacted with them. And the little kind of romance that I think it was ED4 had with the Treadwell droid. She called him Treadwell, which I just thought was kind of a fun way to, you know, the Tread droid. But it was just so great how they interacted it. I should say how Brittany and Williams interacted it with things like C-3PO saying, Millennium Falcon has the most peculiar dialect, you know, and just little things like that. And again, the way that L3 talked about Lando, and even when he was in the cockpit and talking about, you know, looking over at the chair where L3 sat and then giving the salute. There was just, I don't know, there was so much about this that I can't even sit here and mention it all, but without basically reading the whole story. But that was the one that I just absolutely loved.
Yeah, this was the standout for me as well, and my favorite of the entire section. Just to piggyback off some of the things that you said, V5T was the one that kept finding comments rude. And then ED4 was the slicer droid brain that got integrated and did not know all the correct phraseology. And so it kept looking up words that were being used and adding it to the vocabulary and then doing vocabulary searches to find the correct words. And as you said, I think it was V5T was the original droid brain. And it stated in the middle of the story that before the other showed up, it was content just to calculate coordinates and paths. But then it was after ED4 and then L337, especially L337, that she realized that these places were destinations and there was things that were there and things were seeing. And I liked the way that they kept switching to different cams around the ship to see what was going on and how they sensed elevated heart rates in the cockpit when Han and Leia were there. And so they go see what's going on there. And then again, the whole idea of trying to get the warning that the hyperdrive had been deactivated to the central computer. And so they told Treadwell, who managed to download that information to the central computer, but then got destroyed by the stormtroopers that came to deactivate the hard drive in the first place. So it was a very clever and well-written story featuring at least one person that we were aware of. And I think that's what kind of sets it apart from some of the stories that I didn't particularly like, which was there was characters that I had no idea who they were. I'm not sure that knowing about them enhanced my appreciation of anything with regards to Star Wars. This was the exact opposite of that. This was really cool after Solo to see L337 again. And just her rebuke of Lando when he's sitting in the cockpit, like, how could you gamble the Falcon? Mm-hmm. Something that meant so much to you after you downloaded my consciousness into this ship. Just that hurt that she had, even though she still had all this affection for Lando, and how she went out of her way to flash that image of Bespin in Cloud City and uploaded the information that Lando was the administrator there so that Han would notice it. There was just so many great details about that story.
Oh, I agree. And that so many great callbacks to Solo in general. And I also love the way that, you know, as you were saying with the three droid brains in ED4 that was trying to find all the vocabulary. And then she would, and in the audiobook, it was so great because she would pause and then say, looking for, you know, word,
vocabulary search.
This. And then there was a point where she would reject it. So it really personified these droid brains and made you feel for them. And I just thought that was just so cool. And just, again, with being able to witness the kiss between Han and Leia and all of that, it was so great.
Yeah. Well, one of the ones that stood out to me was the "But What Does He Eat?" by S.A. Chakraborty. And the first time I read it, it was just okay. It was fine. But then the second time I read this story was after having rewatched Ratatouille, which is the Disney movie about the rat that learns how to cook. And I just had so much fun reading the story about the chef, the executive chef on Cloud City. She's a Deveronian named Toro Sabazzle. And she's seemed very French. I hate to disparage her, it's French. But she knew how good she was. She had a big ego about her cooking skills. And she has a lifestyle. She sleeps during the day. She gets up. She runs her kitchen. She ends her evenings with getting applause from the people she's fed. And then she goes back to her room and she drinks a glass of Alderanian wine. Then she goes to sleep. And then she repeats the whole thing over again the next night. And she had studied plant life and pharmacology when she was growing up so that she could one day take over the family business and pharmacy and drug making and the like. But then she put those skills towards being an excellent cook. And then one day she gets woken up in the middle of the day, which she shouldn't have been, because she's had hours left to sleep, because Lando needs a favor. And when she gets there, it's because there are very important guests and Lando needs refreshments. And it turns out it's Darth Vader and the Empire have shown up, and he's trying to impress them that, you know, we're taking you seriously. And so he's pleading with her to make these refreshments. So just then getting an opportunity to see her thoughts about, well, if I make these dumplings and I integrate this and I could, you know, I just have to make a refreshment, get out of here. Then she realizes this is going to be the last meal that I ever make, and I'm not going to die having made something mediocre. I don't know. There was just something really charming about that story. Does it mean anything in the grand scheme of Star Wars? Maybe not. And so, but it was fun to read. It is plausible in the movie, which some of these stories I just didn't think were. And I just like the way it worked out with some fun characters.
Oh yeah. I, of course, being a culinary teacher, this one stood out to me as well. And everything that you said about her lifestyle and the way that she acts as a chef, and just her upbringing in her botany and just learning about all of these plants, all of that is so true of anyone that works with food. And just the way that with sleeping during the day and then being awake at night. And I have to say, this was one of the stories that I was really excited for when we first learned that we were getting this in FACPOV, because I thought, okay, this has got to be so much fun to see that kind of behind the scenes of what happened during that banquet scene. And she really does throw out a lot of different kinds of names of foods that you may not know of in Star Wars. But what I found out was that a lot of them are actually featured in other places. So she lists things like Sunberry Ale, which was in the Ewoks cartoon, Chalk Root, Denta Beans, Wilk Milk, which was actually an Aftermath, Zaffa Oil, Muya Fruit. So there's like all these different references to these foods. And I really appreciated that a lot. I mean, just those little details that were in there that, yeah, I mean, they're not really necessary kinds of details, but just really, really great overall. And I loved her as a character. It was just fun to follow Toro through the whole thing.
Absolutely. So what was next on your list?
Well, actually, I kind of liked the Into the Clouds by Karen Strong, which I know is one of those stories that doesn't really have a whole lot of meaning necessarily in terms of the whole, again, grand scheme of things. But what I liked about this one was this was a story about a young gal who was kind of a debutante, I guess you could say. And her parents were very wealthy, and her father liked to gamble, and she liked to gamble too. But the thing about it was that she always wanted to be someone else. So her father basically wanted her to act like stronger and all of these other types of things. And so she goes into this little boutique, and she had heard that this princess, the Princess of Alderaan, was there. And so she wanted to find out what she was wearing and how she had her hair done and those types of things. So for me, of course, being the clothes person and the textiles person, I picked up on the fact that, you know, knowing what Leia was wearing at Bespin at the time, that her hair was actually done in what I now understand to be the Bespin traditional style. And also what she was wearing and the type of silk that it was. So it just kind of made me wonder at that point, well, when did Leia get a chance to kind of go to the spa? You know, I know that they wanted to treat them very well, but it's obvious that Leia was taken to this shop and she was given the opportunity to have someone fit her for this gown and whatnot. And of course, you know, she was always dressed to the nines whenever she had a chance, but Leia's usually in a very utilitarian kind of a thing. So it was, I remember watching Empire Strikes Back for the first time thinking that whole outfit was kind of almost out of place, but yet now thinking about it in the way of how it fits into the entire, you know, Cloud City kind of thing, it does make more sense. But this story also had just a little bit of romance in it, where she ends up with the pilot at the end, and they end up going off together, and she decides that she's going to be her own person and that she's taken the side. Like, she's basically taken the side of the rebellion. And so it was just kind of like a soul searching sort of a thing. But I just, like I said, I just kind of appreciated the whole references to the fashion and the hairstyles and being that Leia wannabe, so to speak, but finding her own way.
Yeah, this is where tastes clash, because this is one that just did not work for me. And I can appreciate why you liked it. But just for me, when I was reading the story and listening to her go on and on and on, I mean, I understood that she was excited about here that the princess was on the station. I was like, okay, so we've got something going on here. But I guess the details that I focused on were her relationship to the pilot and how she was just like, why are you bothering me? Why did you follow out here? And it seemed Han and Leia light to me.
Oh, and I could see that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I just was like, is that what we're supposed to get out of this? And then, yeah, she made the choice. She made the decision to take a side. I just didn't feel like those story elements were strong enough. The fashion bit that you were talking about was very well highlighted in that story, but it just didn't stand to me as the point. So again, like I said, it just is a clash of tastes when it comes to this one. And I'm glad you enjoyed it. It just didn't quite work for me on that one.
Yeah, fair enough. And honestly, this one was one of the only ones that I didn't listen to on the audiobook. I actually read this one while my dogs were playing outside on one of the very rare nice days that we've had lately. Uh-huh. And so maybe just reading it made it a little bit better too. Maybe the audiobook would have been annoying in that way.
Yeah, I didn't have a problem with the narration or anything. It's just, and I think both times I've been through the story, I was on a dog walk listening to it. And mm-hmm. I gave it a fair shot the second time. And at the end, it was just I don't know that it really, I'm looking for the story to either enhance something that I didn't know or hadn't thought about with Star Wars, or even if I had thought about it, or to have some sort of other entertainment factor for it. And again, it seems like you really found value in the fashion discussion there. And that's, I think, put right over my head. So,
and that's okay.
When it came down to it.
Differently.
Right. All right. Well, my next one, and quite frankly, it really surprised me, was the Do on Batuu story by Rob Hart, which is about Willrow Hood. And it explains why he's running through Bespin Cloud City with the Kamtano. There, it's because he is just this lower level engineer worker on the station, but he gets an offer from a Rodian to transport this Kamtano, which he doesn't know what it contains, to this person on Batuu by the name of Tropos. And he gets 10,000 credits in advance to get it there, and there'll be 40,000 more if he gets it there intact. But it comes with a catch. If you screw this up, Tropos does not have a sense of humor and will kill you and wipe everyone that you love out. And so, you know, do it and do it well. And it seems like an easy job, right? You know, take the Kamtano, get on a transport and go. So he asks a friend to pilot him there named Bexley. And then, of course, things go wrong because they've been drinking. They're hanging out in this place and Bexley tries to steal it and do it for herself. And as they're sorting this all out, the Empire invades Cloud City and then things go all kinds of haywire. And ultimately, it becomes more important just to take the money and run at the end of the story, because whatever's in the Kamtano may have been damaged. And yeah, this smuggler's life that he's been dreaming of, he decides is ultimately not for him. This story just surprised me. I could not imagine a story featuring Willrow Hood that I would have found interesting. I found the audio narration on the Audible version of the book really, really well done. I wish I could remember the narrator's name. He did a great job with that. But it's a good story. And it just, like I said, just surprised me. I really liked it. And I guess part of it's because Willrow Hood has become such a joke in the fan community. We have the running of the Willrow Hood celebration, you know, with everyone's got mm-hmm. their ice cream makers and, you know, they chant, what do we want? Ice cream. When do we want it now? And that type of a thing. But then to get a story with a bit of meaning behind it was a surprise.
And I agree with you. I was so in love with the story. And of course, you know me with Will Rowhood. I just always thought that was the most hilarious thing ever. But I just think one of the funniest things in this whole story was the fact that he was looking forward to having some Nectros Freeze once he's on Batuu. And Nectros Freeze is ice cream. And essentially, he's carrying an ice cream maker. So yeah. I just thought that that was hilarious. But we still never found out what was in the Comptano, for sure. And I still want to know who this Tropos guy or whatever it was. Like, why? Who is this person, and why did they kill your family members? But so there was that part of that too. But yeah, everything that you just said was all about this story was amazing, and I just really appreciated the way that they did encapsulate this characterization of, again, like this just obscure character. But I think that this whole section of the book too does a great job of kind of showing you, and again, obviously different points of view, of what's happening at the same exact moment. Because a lot of these stories all revolve around when Lando gets on the comp and he says, you know, you need to get out of Cloud City. And of course, I'm paraphrasing there. But yeah, I did. I really, really liked this story a lot too. And I'm so glad that we were able to get that characterization for Will Rowe. And I wonder if it'll have any effect on the running of the hoods from now on.
Yeah, I'd love to have a collection of all the different narrators that read that line. Attention, attention, this is Lando Calrissian. Yeah. The Imperials have taken over the station. Advise you, abandon, you know, whatever he says there. But yeah, they all read it. It came up again and again and again and again through all these stories in this part of the book. So what's next on your list?
Oh, gosh, this is a hard one because there was a couple that were sort of up there for me, but I'm going to have to go with Right Hand Man by Lydia Kang. And I've never read anything by her before. And there's actually a few different authors that I was not familiar with their work before. But this is the story about the 2-1-B droid that is getting ready to add Luke's prosthetic hand after his fight with Vader. And it's the same droid that worked with him on Hoth and had him in the Bacta tank. And so it just happens to be that this little 2-1-B droid is kind of a poet. And he tells Luke all of these different kinds of things about you have to be accepting and you have to be open to the healing and not suffering. And you don't want to suffer because that just prolongs your healing process. And there were so many little things that he talked about in there with just the ways that Luke was really kind of not wanting the prosthetic hand. Like, he didn't think that he deserved it. He thought that maybe there was a part of him that needed to have that suffering. And, you know, just all of the different things that he was saying to the 2-1-B droid. And then the 2-1-B was really kind of like a counselor for Luke at that point. And I was kind of fascinated with just knowing how the prosthetic was working. They used a lot of different sorts of anatomical kinds of terms in there too, which of course goes along with what a 2-1-B would do, but kind of makes me wonder, because the 2-1-B actually had a lot of, seems like, prior knowledge of the way that Jedi and Sith got their arms cut off, because he mentioned that. And, you know, from his experience with the way that they had been cut off in the past. So I'm thinking that there might be a little bit more of a story behind this little droid than meets the eye, perhaps. But yeah, so, and he was really annoyed by the FX droid too, which I thought was really hilarious. But it was just a really great story, a very, very interesting, endearing type of a story.
Yeah, he didn't want to hear FX7. He didn't want FX7 to hear him, you know, say to Luke, you know, may the force be with you. And then when Luke didn't hear it the first time, he repeats it really fast. May the force be with you. The FX7 wouldn't give him any grief about it. This was one of my favorites as well. From this section is probably my second favorite of the stories. And it caught me by surprise that how insightful 2-1-B could be without even realizing that what 2-1-B was saying was being insightful, because 2-1-B was giving good medical advice. As you mentioned, you know, you've had these seven severed nerves, and so there's this potential for phantom pain for the rest of your life because there's, you know, this signal's been cut off and they can't ever be released. And then there's this idea, you know, the prosthetic is neither good nor bad, it just is. And it's something that you add to you. And of course, Luke is concerned because his father was built out of prosthetics, and he just fought him, and he's afraid of becoming like his dad. And so he makes mention of the Bacta on how the person getting the prosthetic has to be willing to get the treatment, and it strikes a chord with Luke, like being like the Force. And so he, some of it's intentional, but a lot of times too, Umbi doesn't realize the effect he's having on Luke by the words that he's saying, because he's meaning one thing and Luke is interpreting it another way. And so it really worked out really, really well. And I like that one quite a bit. And frankly, if you'd told me this was going to be a highlight in the book for me, I would have been very surprised. But it was quite a good story. I like the way that worked out a lot. And, you know, too, Umbi is observing when Leia and R2-D2 and C-3PO walk into the room. She seems down and she's crestfallen, but she has no visible injuries. That, you know, some part of her is missing, but, you know, but she doesn't have any injuries. Well, of course, she's missing Han. And so it's just kind of this, he's had all these insightful things to say, but he doesn't get the idea of a broken heart for Leia. So it was just a nice, you know, little touch to the end of the story.
Right. And who knew that just Luke getting his hand put on in that little scene was, there was so much to it. And, you know, as you were talking too, I was trying to think of some of the other highlights in there. And you were talking about how he said, you know, with Luke accepting this hand. And I just thought it was really great. He said something along the lines of, there's things are not inherently good or bad unless you choose to make it that way. Mm-hmm. And so that was, you know, he was a very good counselor in that way. And Luke was really struggling because he was talking about like his crude matter and how it didn't matter, how that didn't matter. And I guess I didn't realize too, with Bacta being a living organism kind of thing, that there was some sort of the symbiosis that needed to happen between the person that was getting it and the Bacta itself. So yeah, it was actually a pretty enlightening story, really.
Yeah. The one thing about the Bacta is that it seems to be a little bit at odds with what we're learning in the High Republic about Bacta. Mm-hmm. And so, again, we've had conversations in the past about this kind of sliding scale of canonicity of these stories. And right. As much as I enjoy, and you can still enjoy this without maybe the Bacta interpretation being the official canon explanation for it. But I just thought it was charming is not quite the right word, but I really like the way it worked out with 2-1-B doing his job as a doctor. And then having a profound counseling effect on Luke as well.
Yes, definitely.
All right. Well, last one that I'm going to cover here, and then we can get into some honorable mentions, is the No Time for Poetry. And this story is kind of out of place because it featured Dengar and IG-88, and they're still hunting for Han Solo, which they've already lost that because Boba Fett's cornered him on Bespin. But they've taken coordinates out of Fett's ship, which Fett planted there, and they're not accurate at all. They ended up tracking down a different YT freighter, and it just happens to be the personal pleasure ship of a gangster. And when they end up disabling it, they figure this out, and then there's kind of an awkward standoff with the captain of the ship, and they get paid off in some Beskar to go away and not disrupt what's going on with these gangsters as they're trying to divide up this debris field by gambling for it. And it's not that anything particularly outstanding happens in the story, but after watching season one of The Mandalorian and seeing IG-11 so much, just kind of getting a similar droid in IG-88 and the way he relates to Dengar and other organics in this story was fun. And I thought the performance of Dengar in the audiobook was also good. And it's not, again, it's not the most spectacular story here. And as I was saying earlier, this section of the book was my least favorite of three. Not that it was inherently overall bad, but I just felt that the first two were overall better. But an interesting story about the bounty hunters, and especially when you compare it to the story about Forlom and Zuckuss. It's just head and shoulders above that one that came earlier in the book. So there it is.
Oh, I agree. And I think that with IG-88 and Dengar too, they have a little bit more notoriety. So there's, I guess, a little bit more of a buy into their characters than perhaps Forlom and Zuckuss, even though, I mean, they're cool and all, but you know, but I love how Dengar called him Iggy. because I feel like I don't know where that nickname actually originated from, but I always think of, okay, here's my Robot Chicken reference, right? Mm-hmm. That particular episode of Robot Chicken where they called him Iggy Pop, which I thought was hilarious. But it was neat to kind of see how IG-88 was sort of almost mocking Dengar in a lot of ways, from his accent to the way that he didn't need to even turn his head to actually look at him, and he second guessed him and all of these other things, because Dengar kind of gets a bad rap, no pun intended, you know, his head's wrapped, but still. But I did like the story overall. It definitely wasn't one of my like all time favorites of this particular section or even the book in general, but it was a fun story. I did pick up on a couple of things though, that they mentioned the Bracca shipyards, which of course my head went, ugh, like from Jedi Fallen Order, you know, kind of thing. And then the rivalry to the Hutt clan that they mentioned in there, and the gal that they end up with her ship, you know, trying to thinking it was Han. Do we know her from anything else? Is there any other medium or, you know, comic books or anything like that you know that where she appears?
No, I did not look them up afterwards, and they didn't ring a bell when I read it. So if they've appeared elsewhere, I'm ignorant to that fact.
Okay. I was just curious. But yeah, it was a fun little story overall.
Okay. Well, before we wrap this up, did you have any honorable mentions you wanted to get out there?
Not really, actually. I mean, the rest of them from here on out were just kind of like fell off the cliff for me in a okay. lot of ways.
So, yeah, I didn't really have, you and I had significant overlap on our lists here, with the one exception of the End of the Clouds story here. But how about some that maybe didn't work for you?
Well, one for me that didn't work was The Witness. And this one was by Adam Christopher. And this has to do, you know, you talked about Han and Leia 2.0 or Han and Leia Light. This is like Finn Light for me. Mm-hmm. And here's this female stormtrooper who, okay, it was kind of cool to know that she was the one that was escorting Vader everywhere pretty much. And she was in the carbonite freezing chamber and witnessed that whole thing. And there was a lot of different things that she was around for. So now that when I watch The Empire Strikes Back, I'm going to be like, oh, okay, that's Dina. But there's just other things that I just felt like, okay, it's just way too convenient that she's witnessing everything that happened between Vader and Luke. And she's mm-hmm. cowering in the corner, but she's catching little pieces of the information that they were having in their conversation. And then ultimately she ends up, again, picking a side and becoming a rebel, so to speak. But overall, I don't know. I just felt like it didn't work for me. And they did talk about there was a fanatic stormtrooper in this one, too, that he had his number tattooed on his chest. And he would always make sure that he displayed it proudly. And it was actually her, quote unquote, wingman kind of thing that would escort Vader with her on all these different types of trips. You know, the person that didn't need an escort, she called Vader, which I thought was actually kind of funny. But overall, I don't know. The story just didn't sit well with me.
Yeah. It didn't make my favorites list. It didn't necessarily go on my list of ones that didn't work, but I did kind of have that same response to you, which was, well, this is convenient. You ended up everywhere where all the action was happening, and what are the odds of that? And no one saw you. So, okay.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, she made mention that, you know, she took off the armor and then was wandering around Cloud City in just the bodysuit, and that, you know, that fits in. I was like, does it really? Okay. Everyone else is wearing a lot more brighter colors or white around there. I don't mm-hmm. know. So fine. For me, on the list of ones that didn't work, and we don't have a whole lot of time to discuss these, so I'm just going to sign them up, is the first one is The Man Who Built Cloud City by Alexander Freed. It's about a guy who, as best I can tell, is the delusional homeless guy that hangs out on the bench, and he believes that he is the king of Bespin and that he's made Lando the regent at some point, and now Lando's betraying them by turning the city over to the Empire. And then he gets dragged around by one of the guardsmen of the city and has to be pandered to in his belief so they can get him out of there. I don't get this story or why this guy was so important to this one particular guardsman and what there is to believe and what there is to take away from this story. It seems like there was some sort of a good idea behind it. It just, the execution didn't work.
I agree. I was confused too. Very confused. So I don't know if he was just delusional and, you know, he just happened to be in this, because they called him a vagrant at one point too. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it didn't work for me either.
Yeah, everyone just kind of knew who he was and tolerated him. But anyway, and then the other one for me was Bessemer Escape by Martha Wells. It features Ugnaughts. The audio version of this is so hard to get through because there is so much squealing and grunting every time the characters open their mouths, and that happens all the time. And it was the second time I tried to get this story, I almost just stopped and skipped to the end because it was just that much of a challenge. And I read the story, but I'm going to have a hard time telling what it's about because, again, just trying to tune out all that noises that were going on all the time was annoying.
Yeah, you did a very good job with that. I was the same way. And from what I gathered, it was basically the story about this Ugnaught family trying to just escape with everyone else, which, you know, again, it's the same thing happening throughout at the same time when Lando is saying his announcement, and from the point of view of different people in their personal situation. But yeah, the grunting and everything was just, and you and I had talked about this, is listening to it in double speed and triple speed and then listening to those grunts at that speed.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was almost comical.
All right, any others for you before we wrap this up?
Not really. I mean, that very last thing with the Will Strike Back was bizarre in the audio version, which I'm assuming that was just some kind of recollection of two creative minds that were trying to figure out how to put together the crawl for The Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah, it was a follow-up to the last story in the last FACPOV from A New Hope, where written by Tom Engelberger, where you had one of the, you know, you had the Journal of the Wills and the one guy got tasked to write it, and then you had a critic looking over his shoulder, you know, critiquing everything where he chose to start. And so this was the follow-up to that. I thought it was funny. Again, it doesn't really meet the criteria of, does this impact the way that you view the story overall, other than to call into question some of the choices and the way that the crawl was written. But it's just kind of there for humor's sake.
Yeah, I get it. I did like how you got a sense for little things, like when Lando talked about in passing, dealing with labor disputes and da-da-da. You actually get that in this, you know, talking about these different labor disputes and at all of the different levels with all the different things that were going on with people. So I thought that was really cool. And then at one point they mentioned a tip-yip race. I can't remember what story that was in, but I thought, tip-yip. We were just talking about roasting that during the Star Wars Lego special. Holiday special.
For me, I think it's interesting that a lot of these stories in this part of the book, either they have characters that didn't appear in the movie at all, and then they're like in situations that never really came up in the movie. That I thought, always kind of looked at the FACPOV stories from A New Hope in this book as being, this was the guy that was in the corner, or, you know, in the bar or whatever. This is the guy that walked between Han and Leia. You know, we had that story from earlier this book. Or this is one of the various people that's hanging out in the canteen on Mos Eisley. We had a number of characters in this section of the book that were nowhere on screen ever that I can, I can tell. You know, the guy who's supposed to be the king of Cloud City, or, you know, in the End of the Clouds story, we had the debutante and the pilot. And if they were in the movie, I couldn't tell you where. And that's all fine, but, you know, with the exception of being stuff like, you know, but what does he eat, when we're talking about the chef who did not appear, but it was something that impacted directly a scene that was happening in the movie. And like, you could hear events, you know, you Han Solo and Leia and Chewbacca walked into that dining room and we got to hear the gunshots and what was going on in response to that. But then there's just some of these stories that had characters and there was practically no connection to the movie at all. And so that was just unusual for me.
Right. And you touched upon a lot of them. And then there was that other story too, Beyond the Clouds, where the Isabella was, you know, dealing with some of her, you know, labor disputes and also becoming a hunter, like a bounty hunter, and trying to figure out her way with that.
Big fan of Boba Fett.
Yeah, which was kind of interesting. So you never see her either. But still, I mean, it kind of worked to intertwine some of the stuff. And for what it is, and we've said before, you know, this book was done out of charity. I mean, all of the proceeds are going to charity. So the stories are they are what they are. And as we said, are they really canon? Maybe. But they're just fun. And why not?
Right. Exactly. All right. Well, I think then that will wrap it up for this discussion of part three of From a Certain Point of View, The Empire Strikes Back, and the book overall. So we're done now with that one, and we'll turn our attention to the next book here soon. But we'd like to thank you all for listening to this episode of Podcast Stardust, and we'd like to remind you that we are part of the RetroZap Podcast Network, and that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on RetroZap.com. You can also subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher of choice, which includes such fine podcatchers as Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Overcast, Amazon Music, Audible, Ghana, if you're in India. You name it, we should be on there. And if we're not, let me know, and I will do what it takes to get us there. But you can also find us on the RetroZap podcast feed with all the other great RetroZap shows. Just a couple other things. If you've got a few moments and you're feeling generous, we would love it if you could head it over to Apple Podcasts and leave us a 5-star rating and review. That does help us get known in the podcast community. And don't forget to look us up on social media and chat with us about Star Wars there. Jay, if you could be so kind, remind everybody one more time where we are online and around the internet.
Sure. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And if you'd like to reach out to Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can always check out our Pinterest boards and our YouTube channel, which has all of our episodes as well as our unboxing videos of some really great products. And you can always join us for some great Star Wars discussion on our Discord channel on the RetroZap Discord server. And to do that, just go to our show page and click on the community tab, and you are there. And last but not least, you can always support us on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And you can pick up all of your Podcast Stardust swag, like t-shirts, sweatshirts, coffee mugs, refrigerator magnets, pillows, totes, stickers, phone cases, just about anything you want. And it's over there. So teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust.
All right, that'll do it for episode 228. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.